Hello guys, welcome to my YouTube channel Chem5. Today we are going to discuss about the qualitative analysis of the group 2 cations. Group 2 cations contain arsenic ion, bismuth ion, cadmium, copper, mercury, antimony and tin ion. Some book will refer that the lead plus 2 ion is also considered as group 2, but here we are not going to consider lead plus 2 as a group 2 cation. For the analysis of the group 2 cation, we need sulfide ion in acidic media. In the previous video, I told you that the group 2 cations give precipitation in the of their correspondent sulfides in acidic condition. So we have to maintain acidic condition to keep the sulfide ion concentration in the solution very low, because the sulfides of the group 2 cations, the solubility products is very low. So here I am giving a chart of the solubility product of the sulfides of group 2 and the group 3 cations, and you can see that the solubility product of the HGS is about 10 to the power minus 54. There are many examples to realize that how big is 10 to the power 23, the Avogadro number is. So you can easily visualize that the how small is this number, 10 to the power minus 54. And if you see the ASP of the other sulfides, that the lead sulfide has 10 to the power minus 28, SN has 10 to the power minus 25 order. So it is very low. So within a little bit concentration of sulfides in the solution, this ion will give precipitates of their correspondent sulfides. But if you see the KSP of the group 3 cations, you can see that it is little bit higher than this. So if I see the lowest KSP of the group 3 cation is about 10 to the power minus 23, and the highest KSP of group 2 is about 10 to the power minus 25. Even it is about 100 time difference. So that is why we have to keep a sulfide ion at very low concentration. So otherwise we can found some precipitation of group 3 cations also, and which will lead to wrong results. So here that's why we use the acid to keep the concentration of sulfide at required minimum. So here we generally use a strong acid, because strong acid is a strong electrolyte. It dissociates completely in the solution and increase the concentration of H plus ion in the solution, whereas H2S is a weak acid, and that's why the increased concentration of H plus shifts the equilibrium of the reaction in reverse direction of this reaction. So and maintain a minimum concentration of sulfide ion in the solution. So that is why we have to use acidic media to keep the concentration of sulfides and minimum. And so generally what we do in the lab, we take a little bit of solution, sample solution, and pass H2S through it. If any precipitation occurs, then we go for the further acidifying the whole solution, and then pass the H2S from the whole solution. Otherwise we generally avoid this step. So here so which acid we should use in lab? Generally we use dilute HCl to make the acidic media. So what if we use any other acid? So concentrated HCl cannot be used. It may cause precipitation of the group 3 ions and lead to the wrong result. So generally we use 4 to 6 molar HCl. H2SO4 cannot be used, because there are in the group 5, you can remember that calcium ion is present. If calcium ion is present in the solution, using H2SO4 may cause the precipitation of CaSO4, which will also lead to the wrong results. And if we use the HNO3, HNO3 is a strong oxidizer, you know, so it will oxidize the sulfide ion and make the colloidal sulfur. So there will be no precipitation of sulfides of the cations. So if we add, if we make acidic media of the solution and pass the H2S, and if group 2 ions are present in the solution, we will find precipitation. And it is interesting that the precipitation of various colors, black HGS, lead sulfide, copper sulfide causes the black precipitation, while bismuth sulfide and tin sulfide causes brown precipitation, and cadmium sulfide, arsenic sulfide has a very good yellow color, while the antimony sulfide gives orange precipitation. So if you find any particular color of precipitation, it will be easy for you to detect the which cation is present. But if you find the mixture of this, suppose a mixture of black and brown, you really cannot distinguish by the inspection that which color of precipitation is actually is, and then you have to go for the confirmatory test for the each ion. But you can see that the most of the ions, that is Ag, lead, bismuth, tin, arsenic, are heavy metals and toxic also, whereas arsenic is very toxic and harmful to environment. So in generally, school labs and the undergraduate labs give students to the copper plus 2 ion, and in extreme cases they can give bismuth, cadmium or tin, or nothing more than that. So here we are going to analyze a nice solution. We don't want to make our life unnecessarily complicated. So we will assume that our solution contain only copper, bismuth and antimony and tin. So move to the next slide. So as you can see that the group 2 ions have lots of ions in the present. So there is subgroups. So there is two subgroups. One is copper subgroup, that is called the group 2A, and another is arsenic subgroup, that is called group 2B. So what is the difference of these subgroups? So group copper subgroup contains the Ag plus ion, lead plus 2 ions. It will be Ag plus 2, lead plus 2, copper plus 2, bismuth plus 10, Cd plus 3. And the arsenic subgroup contain As plus 3, Sb plus 3 and Sn plus 4. So how can we distinguish these groups? That the copper subgroup, these sulfides are insoluble in ammonium polysulfide, a yellow liquid, NH4O2SX, the formula of the liquid, and KOH solution. So the sulfides of the copper subgroup are insoluble in the ammonium polysulfide solution and the basic KOH solution. But the sulfides of the arsenic subgroup can dissolve in the ammonium polysulfide and KOH solution. The sulfides are quite amphoteric in nature. Why I state this statement, we can know a little later, that the Cu subgroup, both group sulfides can dissolve in HNO3. That the copper sulfides and the copper subgroup sulfides and the arsenic subgroup sulfides can be dissolved into HNO3 solution, and arsenic subgroup sulfides can also be dissolved in the KOH solution. So that's why we say that the arsenic subgroup sulfides can also can be dissolved in both basic and acidic media. So that's why we say that the sulfides of arsenic subgroup are quite amphoteric in nature. But caution, in the previous slide we have shown that the AgS has a very very low KSP, that is 10 to the power minus 54, and that is why AgS from the Cu subgroup, it is insoluble in HNO3. So we need aqua regia to dissolve AgS. So suppose we have a solution left after group 1 separation, and we add 6 molar HCl and H2S are added and centrifuge, the precipitation of sulfide of mostly group 2 ions will form. So here I use H2S, but now some lab will use Na2S also, and some will use thioacetamide, a good sulfide ion donor. So generally H2S is used, but H2S is a poisonous gas, you know, and it is also harmful to environment. So now some of the labs are going to use Na2S because it will produce the H2S gas in the solution, whereas if we use the keep apparatus, then we have to pass the H2S gas from the solution, and most of the H2 gases are released in the environment and it can causes harm. So here we are assuming that we are using H2S gas. So the solution left after the group 1 separation, 6 molar HCl and H2S gas are added in the solution and we centrifuge it. If the group 2 ions are present, we found their precipitation, maybe various colors of precipitation that can lead us to particular atom. So then we separate the precipitation by centrifuging and add KOH solution in that precipitation and centrifuge it again. As I say that the copper subgroups cannot be dissolved in the KOH solution, but arsenic subgroups can be. So whichever ion are present in the copper subgroups, they cannot be dissolved and they will form a precipitation, whereas the arsenic subgroup sulfides will dissolve into the KOH solution. By centrifuging, we can take the precipitation and the whole solution into different test tubes. So then first we do the analysis of the copper subgroup. We take the copper subgroup in a test tube and add 6 molar HNO3 and we heat it. We know that the copper sulfides can be dissolved into the 6 molar HNO3. So we add it and heated it. So what happens, as this HNO3 is a oxidizing acid, the sulfides will oxidize and the solution will contain only the copper plus 2 and Bi plus 3 ions. As I say that we are only considering Cu plus 2, Bi plus 3, Sb plus 2 and Sn plus 2 ions. So the copper subgroups contain the bismuth and the copper ion. So as we add the 6 molar HNO3 in the copper subgroup precipitation and heat it, the sulfide of their respective ions will oxidize and the solution will contain the bismuth plus 3 ion and the copper plus 2 ions, while the residue will contain the oxidized sulfur or the normal sulfur. So then we will add excess concentrated ammonia, aqueous ammonia, in the solution. So if copper is present, so the solution color first gives a whitish blue precipitation, and if we add excess of concentrated NH3, the solution color will turns into deep blue. And if it is happens, we can certainly say that the Cu plus 2 ion is present in the solution, while it will form a white precipitate of the bismuth hydroxide. So if we add sodium stannite reagent, it is the confirmatory test of bismuth, sodium stannite reagent, then the black precipitation of bismuth will occur, and the corresponding reaction is it that the bismuth hydroxide reacts with sodium stannite reagent in basic media, as we already added the concentrated NH3, which is a base, and the bismuth solid will precipitate and it will get oxidized. So the next slide for the confirmatory test of the copper. So one confirmatory test is that we get the solution, we add a little bit of ammonia in the solution in the presence of H2. Copper plus 2 will give a whitish blue color precipitate, which is due to the basic copper sulfate. So if we add excess ammonia in it, we will found that the if we add excess ammonia, then the basic copper sulfate will convert it into a complex ion, that is CuNH3O4+2, and the solution turns into deep blue color due to this ion CuNH3O4. And the next confirmatory test is potassium ferrocyanide, by giving potassium ferrocyanide. If we if potassium ferrocyanide is added in the solution, the color of the solution changes to chocolate brown, and this is the corresponding reaction, and the chocolate brown color is due to this complex CO2FeCN6. So I can show you the colors here. So this is the chocolate brown complex, this is for this one CO2FeCN6, and this is the whitish blue precipitation or bluish white, what will you say. So this is due to the adding of low amount of ammonia, and if we add excess ammonia, we can found this kind of deep blue color. Arsenic subgroup will dissolve in the KOH solution. We take the solution, we will add concentrated HCl and heat it, and after that centrifuge it. So concentrated HCl will generally oxidize these metals and form their respective chlorides, and they are in solution, while the residue, if we get, they contain mostly sulfur. So now we centrifuge it and take the solutions in another test tube and do the following test. If in the solution, after treating with the concentrated HCl, Hg2Cl2 solution is added and heated and centrifuge it, we can found the silky precipitate of Hg2Cl2, which confirms the presence of the Sn+2. So in the precipitation in the different test tube, if we add thioacetamide or H2S, I say that the thioacetamide is also a good sulfide ion donor, or we can simply give the H2S. We can found the orange precipitation of the antimony Sb+3 ions, Sb2S3, which is the sulfide of antimony, and it will confirm the precipitation of the, and it will confirm the presence of the antimony. So if you like this video, please like it, share it, and please subscribe my channel. Thank you for watching this.